12 noon Eastern Time, and this is PPG World Service. We are bringing today a special edition broadcast. As you guys know, Louise and I are normally on the air on the first Sunday of every month. This is not the first Sunday, but we are more than happy to utilize our Sunday to chat to Pat Miller, who's always a huge, huge source of knowledge. So today we're talking to Pat Miller. We're going to be asking Pat all about everything that she's up to, and there's probably plenty of that. And we're also going to talk to her about her 2016 summit presentations. She's doing three, I believe. Copy that. Training Dogs with Imitation, Shape Up, and Reactive Rovers. So first of all, before we get to Pat, let me just welcome Louise Stapleton-Frappell, who's my co-host, who's over there in Spain. So hi, Louise. How are you?
Hi, Niki. I'm fine, thank you. How are you?
I'm absolutely marvelous. I believe you're going to be here next week, aren't you?
Yes, I fly over to Boston next Thursday, and I'm with you the week after. So our next show, we'll be sitting side by side.
Okay, well, that's probably not going to be good news for Victoria Stillwell. We'll have to compete with both of them together. But I'm sure we'll do the best we can. So without any further ado, let's just say hey to Pat. Pat, first of all, thank you for joining us on this Sunday. It's so great to get you on the show.
Oh, it's my pleasure.
It's always a pleasure to chat to you. And I know Louise has got bunches of questions, and I'm hoping we get some live questions coming in as well. So, Lou, over to you.
Thank you, Niki. And hello and welcome to the show, Pat.
Thank you very much, Louise.
I'm going to start by telling everybody a little bit of background information, and I'm sure most people know lots and lots about you, but for those that don't, Pat Miller is the author of many books. We've got The Power of Positive Dog Training, Positive Perspectives 1 and 2, Play with Your Dog, Do Over Dogs, and How to Foster Dogs. And Pat's been training dogs for more than 30 years. She worked for 20 years at the Marin Humane Society in Novato, California, during which time she collaborated with Trish King to create the country's first color coding system for shelter dogs and volunteers. Pat moved to California's Central Coast in 1996 and launched Peaceable Paws and introduced the color coding system at the Santa Cruz SPCA while serving on the board of that organization. In 1999, Miller and her husband Paul relocated Peaceable Paws to Chattanooga, Tennessee. Pat holds an associate degree in administration of justice, is a freelance writer, and a regular contributor to several publications, including the Whole Dog Journal and the Popular Dog Series, and is training editor of the Whole Dog Journal. In 2015, Pat was named by Dog Fancy magazine as one of 45 people who have changed the dog world. Pat and her husband moved to Fairplay, Maryland in the spring of 2004, where they now live and operate their Peaceable Paws Dog Training Center and Peaceable Pastures Horse Boarding Facility. Pat continues to offer group dog training classes, private behavior consults, training camps, seminars, and workshops worldwide, expert witness services for animal-related legal cases, and is director of the Peaceable Paws Trainer Academies and Training Programs. And I'm sure there's much, much more that I can say. But I'm going to leave it there, Pat, because I think that gives a nice roundup. But you have just done so much and are still doing so much. I'd like to start by asking you, first of all, about the Pat Miller Academy that I just mentioned and the courses that are offered. Could you tell us a little bit about it, please, Pat?
I'd love to. We started those in Tennessee, and it actually was a Colorado trainer, Jim Schrader, who prompted me to start the academies. He wanted to come and sort of hang out with me for a week, and I said, you know, there's really not that much in 1 week for you to do. And he goes, well, put together a course. So I did that, and we started the Level 1 Academy in Tennessee. And after moving here to Fairplay, Maryland, we expanded them, and we now have Level 1 basic training and behavior, and then several Level 2 courses. There's a Level 2 canine behavior modification that we offer a couple of times every year, and then sometimes we offer a multi-species academy, which is a Level 2 academy. Sometimes we offer an instructor's course, and then I've done one equine academy, and I'm going to be collaborating with horse trainer Lauren Bond to offer more equine academies here. And then we have level three academies. We just keep on going. There's a level three advanced training and behavior study, a level three canine aggression course, and our newest addition, which I absolutely adore, is our level three canine cognition academy. So we do have several trainers that have taken all of those.
Wow, that is one heck of a curriculum. You are offering some amazing courses there. And you just mentioned actually the one that you're very interested in at the moment is the canine cognition, which obviously that pulls in with one of your topics at the PPG Summit this year, I believe, which is the training dogs with imitation. I presume that pulls into that course.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it does. And the fun thing about that, I remember when I started the academies, the standard in science was that dogs can't learn through imitation. And I would earnestly tell my students that because that's what science told us. And then as we have opened ourselves more to learning about canine cognition, a lot of things we used to think have been turned on their heads, and that's a fun one.
I actually read that you used to tell your students one thing and then you began telling them another thing and now you tell them something totally different, which I think is absolutely awesome because it just shows that, you know, we're all constantly learning new things and adapting our knowledge
exactly.
as we go along. Yeah, yeah.
Exactly, and that's one of the many things I adore about modern positive reinforcement-based training because pretty much everybody knows I'm a crossover trainer. I used to train what I call the old-fashioned way with choke chains and yanks on the collar. And in those days, we never asked why are we doing this or why does this work. Your trainer told you what to do and you did it. And now we are so much more about questioning, you know, why does this work? How does this work? And gee, even if it works, it may be something that I'm not willing to do. So, you know, this goes in the garbage.
Yeah, absolutely, which is, I think is obviously a great advancement because it comes back to just because we can do something, you know, we shouldn't necessarily be doing it.
Exactly.
So, yeah. Okay. What requirements are the PAT for becoming a PAT Miller certified trainer?
So we do offer, and I will tell you for a long time I resisted offering any kind of certification because I really do believe that true professional certification isn't just about passing somebody's courses and, you know, getting a certificate that says you passed it. So when my students get certified, I'm really clear to them, this may be valuable to you. There are people who recognize and value this. And true professional certification involves a much broader education than I'm giving you in a couple of weeks course here. So we have three levels. Having said that, I realized at some point that in order to stay competitive in the market, I needed to offer my students something that recognized the work that they've put in the academies here. So in order to be a PMCT1, you have to successfully complete at least three academies, which are the level one basic training and behavior, level two behavior modification, and then any third academy of your choice. And then we have PMCT2, where you have to complete the level one requirements and also take the advanced training and behavior study, level three advanced training and behavior study, and level two PMCT requires submission of 30 continuing education units every 3 years. And then for level three, you have to have successfully completed five academies, that is the PMCT2 requirements, an additional academy, and attend either a one-week private intern program with me or complete the level one peaceable pause apprenticeship. So it's a lot.
Okay, right. That's a lot. It's a lot, yeah. But I like the fact actually that you said that there's some choice in which academies you know, the trainers can take. That's nice because obviously people do like to go in certain directions, so that's good. What's the difference between a peaceable pause affiliate and a certified trainer?
Peaceable Pause Affiliates, that's a paid program. If you complete the Level 1 Academy with a 90% score or better, or if you successfully complete Level 1 and Level 2 Behavior Modification, you can be a Peaceable Pause Affiliate. And that's, you pay a fee, and you get certain things in return. you get listed as an affiliate, you get a percentage discount on any future, it's an annual fee, but you get a percentage discount on any future academies or workshops you take here. You get a percentage discount on purchases from our store. You get some free phone consultation time with me, either about your own dog or about clients' dogs. So there's a number of benefits. And you get a CD with all of my articles on it and permission to use those as handouts for your own clients.
Okay, wow, that's quite a nice system then. And a certified trainer is obviously the one that has done the courses that you stressed before, doing the level 1, 2, 3,
correct,
et cetera. Yes.
Yeah, correct. Okay. And affiliates have to have taken at least the level 1 course and passed with a 90% score or better, or taken both level 1 and level 2 behavior modifications. So they are also academy graduates.
Okay. And are your courses all at your training center?
They are. For a while, we had a satellite location with Lisa and Brad Wagoner at Cold Nose College in Murphy, North Carolina, and they no longer have their own physical facility, so we stopped doing that satellite academy. So now they're all back here in Maryland.
Right. My next question was actually going to be whether all Pat Miller certified trainers have the same skill sets and knowledge, or whether there were different levels. And actually, you've pretty much answered that because, mm-hmm. you know, you've said that there are the three different levels. Do the trainers tend to go on? You know, I presume that they get slightly hooked and that your level 1 trainers tend to go on and do the level 2 and the level 3, etc.
Many of them do. Yes, many of them do, for sure. Which is lovely. The more they come to, the more I get to know them, the more we have a really personal relationship, which is great because I have, you know, trainers all over the country and some all over the world that I am really comfortable referring to because I've worked very closely with them.
Excellent. And you mentioned as well that you were doing some equine course. I think you said that you were doing a level 2 equine course. Is that correct?
It is. The one that I did before was considered a level 2 academy because they had to have taken the level 1. I want them to already have the basic training and behavior theory so that the equine course is more about working with the horses and not as much cramming all that information into your head. So it's considered a level 2 course. So I'd offered it once, and we are just starting a relationship with Lauren Bond, and we're looking to October to offer her first equine academy here.
Pat, can I ask you, with the equine academy, do people actually bring their own horses, or are there horses there they can work with?
It's horses here that they work with.
Okay. Okay. Excellent.
Now, Lauren may want to do hers differently, but the one I did was working with horses here.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Is there a big difference, Pat, between working with the horses and working with the dogs?
Well, certainly all the same learning theory applies. We know that. The differences have to do with, you know, anytime you're working with a different species, knowing that species so that you can apply a learning theory in a way that works for that species. So because horses are a prey animal instead of a predator, they are more likely to panic and run when they're frightened as opposed to kind of stand up and fight back defensively. There's a big barrier in the horse world to using treats with horses because of the fear that some 1,000-pound animal starts mugging you for treats. You'll get trampled. And in fact, here's a funny little side note. When I first heard about clicker training, I thought, I don't know about this, and I don't want to mess up my own dog. So the first animal that I clicker trained, that I used a clicker with, was my horse. And because I was so aware of the horse world's concern about horses mugging you for treats, I charged the clicker by clicking if she turned her head away from me. So she learned to beg for treats by turning her head away from me instead of mugging me for treats. It's easy enough to do. So the whole fear about having your horse mug you for treats is sort of a false fear and one that's easy to overcome. But we know the horse world is 10 or 15, maybe 20 years behind where the dog world is in accepting the idea of positive reinforcement-based training.
I clicker trained my 2 miniature dog kids, and I never had problems with them mugging for treats. When I first rescued them, I also had a mini horse, and I was told by a friend who was really into horses, do not give them treats. And obviously, they were still very much using negative reinforcement protocols, and I did just because that was who I was, and I never had problems with the mugging, and I gave them a lot of treats.
Well, you know, we know you get what you reinforce. If you reinforce your horse for mugging, then your horse will learn to mug you. Our mini fetches a tennis ball. It's quite cute.
Oh, wow. I've got to admit, it does fascinate me. I know I was recently at a seminar with Alessandra Curlin, and she was talking about the horses and saying that she starts off by using a target, actually, pretty much as you just said, so that the horse actually backs away or turns away from the treats, so that there isn't this sort of fear of getting mugged for the treats. The horse basically is taught manners, you know, and therefore it's actually a very safe way of training. Yeah.
Yes.
Do you think, you said that you think the equine world is perhaps 15 years behind the dog training world. Do the trainers that come to you or that have come to you in the past for the equine courses, are they coming with any clicker skills? Are they, I'm going to say, sort of crossover trainers, or are they perhaps people that are already using clicker training with their dogs?
The one equine academy that we did was clicker trainers who were already using clicker with their dogs, so it wasn't a hard sell. I mean, and generally people who come here know what they're coming for, so I don't run into a lot of resistance. But the whole horse whisperer thing is, while it is perhaps gentler than some of the old-fashioned cowboy horse breaking stuff, is still very much based in negative reinforcement and not necessarily carefully applied negative reinforcement. I don't think negative reinforcement is, you know, the devil incarnate, but it's used very heavy-handedly by even those that are considered, you know, the modern modern horse whisperers. So this is a significantly different approach than, and you know, a lot of people think they're being really nice to their horses because they're doing horse whisperer stuff, but it's still about applying a whole lot of pressure.
Yeah, about applying the pressure and relieving the pressure. No? I was actually, it's fascinating because I was reading about this just yesterday, and how many people are calling themselves horse whisperers, which I haven't really realized that because, you know, I'm not really into the equine field, but it did amaze me because, in fact, we've got the same parallel, haven't we, in the dog training world, although many of the dog trainers that call themselves whisperers are actually using positive punishment as well as negative reinforcement.
Yeah, I think the dog whisperers are even worse than horse whisperers.
Yeah, so anybody out there who's calling yourself a dog whisperer, you know, just stop. Think about what you're doing.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay, I happen to know that you've got a new book in the works, Pat.
Oh, a little birdie told you, huh?
A little birdie did tell me, yes. Can you give us a little insight? How far along is it? Who's it aimed at?
Okay.
You know, the whole lowdown, please.
The manuscript has been submitted to the publisher, huge load off my shoulders, which is Dogwise. And we're hoping for release around June or July, so it should be available at the PPG Summit in the fall. And it is aimed at both, you know, the fairly sophisticated dog owner as well as dog trainers. So I tend to write in a style, I think, that's accessible to dog owners, whole dog journal readers, who have more than the basic, I like having a dog as a pet, and that's cool, as opposed to the dog owners who recognize that they want to create a relationship with their dog, and they want better communication, and they want more understanding. So what I consider, you know, it's funny, we hear sometimes trainers talk about, you know, the average dog owner, or I haven't seen it done lately, but it used to be abbreviated as ADO, which I found really offensive. And I always say my clients are above average. I don't get average dog owners. So I think the dog owner who's looking to a qualified professional, the dog owner who's committed to training with their dogs, that's all way above average. And so there should be plenty of dog owners that can read the book and benefit from it, as well as, I think, useful information for dog training professionals.
Pat, can I ask you about the book? Is it sort of based on a system, or is it a general information? I mean, how is it structured? Because we're seeing a lot of books now coming out, where people are actually coming out with, you know, systems and...
Yeah, no, it's more general information.
Okay.
Every time I do all that, I go, you know, I really should come up with a Pat Miller system somewhere along the line so I can, you know, profit from it. But I just keep not doing that. It's because even the systems are based on the science.
Right.
I tend to just, you know, present and apply the science as opposed to naming it my own.
I think with the systems, it makes it a more marketable commodity sometimes, doesn't it? Because then people can take it on the road and they can do certification workshops and, you know,
exactly.
It sort of goes on from that. So I see the appeal for doing that. But it also fascinates me now how many people are, I mean, everybody's writing books now. And I think it's great in one respect because it gives people access to a much broader selection of resources. But I think it's like everything, you then have to filter through what's not quite so good versus what's excellent. So
exactly.
I think it can be a bit more confused. I mean, obviously with your name, I mean, no one's going to question the quality or anything, but So it's been published by Dogwise, and it's going to be available at the Summit. That's fantastic. Is it sort of based on your Reactive Rovers program, or is it completely different?
The Reactive Rover stuff is included, but it's much broader than that. I mean, it really is a broad look at aggression, and the premise of the book is... The underlying premise is that we are, for the most part, we are really overreacting to agonistic behavior, which is the whole continuum of behaviors around, you know, social relationships with dogs. And that our culture is so oversensitized to aggression that we overreact to things that if we acted appropriately to them would not be a big deal. Mm-hmm. So, well, I'm not downplaying the fact that dogs can seriously hurt people. I'm trying to get the message across that, you know, look, if your dog resource guards from you, don't jump in and alpha roll him because
right.
you make it worse.
Right.
That resource guarding, for example, is a natural, normal behavior. We all do it. If you lock your house when you leave, you are resource guarding. If you lock your car when you park downtown, you are resource guarding. It's a natural, normal behavior. So rather than demonizing normal behaviors, let's understand them and help our dogs rather than getting into conflict with our dogs and making it worse.
Yeah, I think, and I absolutely agree with you, and that's one of the reasons I love Janice Bradley so much. She's just so realistic about...
Yes, I love her too.
I mean, she's, you know, I mean, I spent half an hour with her one breakfast at the Summit, and I'd love to spend 2 or 3 hours with Janice one-on-one because she's so realistic about the situation with aggression and dog bites. And I think as a community, I think we've sort of, there's a little bit of fear-mongering going on, and I think often I don't know if we do it on purpose, but maybe it's just because we struggle to communicate with clients, but I think we've tended to sort of over-dramatize.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think that's a good thing for our dogs. I really don't.
Exactly. Yeah. I had a client just a couple of weeks ago who a good percentage of my practice is aggression cases. And I had a client whose dog had some aggression issues. And my normal practice, I usually have them come here. I do occasional in-homes, but not very often. And what I find is bringing those dogs here, the vast majority of them, I mean, there have been 2 or 3 in the 12 years we've been here in Fairplay. The vast majority of them, within 5 minutes of coming into the training center on leash, I'm inviting the owner to take the dog off leash. And they look at me and they say, but he bites people. And I said, you know, I've watched him, and I'm comfortable asking you to take him off leash because I'm not going to do the stupid things that people do to get the dog to bite them.
Yeah.
So I was working with this client's dog, and I was luring him down, and I misread him, and he muzzle punched me. And the owner said, oh, he tried to bite you. And I said, actually, no, he didn't try to bite me, because if he had tried to bite me, he would have bitten me. He was giving me a reasonable, polite warning signal that he wasn't comfortable with what I was doing.
Yeah.
And it's huge that people need to realize that much of what dogs do, like a muzzle punch, which is a very clear and serious warning, isn't a dog who tried to bite and missed. It's not a dog who tried to bite and forgot to open his mouth wide enough. It's a dog who was communicating, but very deliberately trying not to bite you.
Yeah, absolutely. And it goes back, and I struggle with this concept is how, I mean, and I'm sort of putting my doggone safe hat on here right now in terms of, you know, bite education, but how we can get people better understanding canine communication. I mean, what can we do? I mean, we've been living with dogs for thousands of years, and yet so many people just don't understand. And I'm not talking about the very subtle signs. I'm talking about the very blatant signs.
The basic stuff, yeah.
Yeah, they just don't seem to understand it.
Well, that's part of the goal of this book, is to defuse or take away, you know, some of the overreaction to the whole range of agonistic behaviors that fall within what people define as aggression.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. Well, it sounds, does the book have a name yet? Are you ready to reveal a name, or will that
it
wait?
It does not have a name yet. Dogwise and I are still in discussions over the name.
Okay, but hopefully it's going to
you'll
be
know it when you that. You'll know it when you see it, though.
Oh, really? Good.
Well, no, I mean, you'll know it's my book about aggression, so there you go. I have to say, though, as I was writing this book, it felt like a much bigger responsibility than any of the other books I've written. Because it's about aggression, because I'm going, oh, I'm now telling people what to do with their dog's aggressive behaviors. That feels a whole lot bigger than teaching them how to sit and lie down.
Well, and it's also one of those behaviors that, you know, poor dogs end up being rehomed or euthanized. I mean, there's awful consequences, isn't there, for the dog if we don't get it right as a professional and as pet owning community. I mean, it's just, I spent 2 or 3 years working as an executive director at Humane Society, and I was horrified at the reasons people brought pets into the shelter. And just, oh my goodness, I mean, life and death decisions are being made based on information that people have access to. It's dreadful.
Yep.
Awful. I actually have I'm going to ask you a really quick question that came in from the audience, and it's to do with horses, so I'm just going to backtrack a little bit.
Okay.
I didn't want to wait until we got too much further into the show, but actually it's Susan Nilsson who's asking, because we've got an article coming up in the next box about how horses see the world differently, and that they don't see the full color spectrum. And I think you may or may not know the answer to this, I don't know. And Susan's asking, do you have any experience in terms of how that color spectrum, how it impacts horses in terms of how they, their sensitivity to certain environmental stimuli or sudden movement? And I, you know, having owned horses and dogs, I absolutely get that horses are a prey rather than predator, so obviously that doesn't make them very different. Do you have any experience with that, with the color?
Not so much with the color spectrum. I do know that horses have a much greater range because their eyes are set on the sides of their heads. They have much better peripheral vision.
Right.
And in addition, as do a lot of prey species, so, because it keeps them safer. And they can't see directly under their noses. So if you're riding a horse and you're going over jumps, at the point when he's taking off for the jump, he doesn't see the jump.
Right.
So those are the two things that I specifically know about horse vision, but I am not familiar with the whole color spectrum. I mean, the same thing is true of dogs. Dogs don't see the same color spectrum we do. So,
right.
But so if anything, what I would say is when there's a certain degree of what we might call color blindness, things may be more likely to blend into each other, which doesn't make sense for a prey species, but it would help explain why horses can be so sensitive to a sudden movement if something's been blending in with the background colors and then moves, as opposed to if they had been able to pick it out because it was a different color coming up on it.
Yeah, that absolutely does make sense. So it was almost just maybe a subtle move, and suddenly it would look like it was just completely jumping out at them.
Right.
Yeah. Well, I guess it's going to be an interesting article that's coming up. So
sounds like one I need to read.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thanks for that.
Uh-huh.
Okay, Lou, back to you.
Cool. Well, you just beat me there, actually, because I was going to ask the same question because I've just seen it pop up. So that's good that, well, I was going to say that we've got the answer, that we've got some sort of answer. You're right as well about the dogs with the, you know, people say dogs are literally colorblind. Now, they're not actually colorblind, are they?
They no, they just see some colors differently than we do, and I don't have the scale in front of me. We've got it posted up in our training center, but I think it is reds don't look like red. They look more like green. So,
isn't there some recent study that came out regarding how dogs respond to color and or shapes and stripes? Because I know I was in Las Vegas in March at a meeting with the fur free community, and they were talking about some of the criteria for the fur free certification is that some of the vets, I believe, I could be wrong, I will clarify this, that they're moving away from white jackets because it's apparently not a relaxing color for dogs to look at, and also not wearing striped shirts.
Stripes and checks and all. I saw that study. I didn't read it cover to cover. But it's one of those where I'm still holding some thoughts in reserve about that. You know, one of the things we do in our Level 3 Advanced Training and Behavior Study courses, about half of it is applying some of the more advanced training techniques to the dogs the students bring, or if they can't bring one, they can borrow one of mine. And half of it is reading and analyzing studies, because there are so many studies out there, and if all you do is take somebody else's interpretation of the study, I mean, you know, the study itself is already the researcher's interpretation of the study, and then you have whoever the reporter is that's writing, or whoever the author is that's writing an article about the study, so you get kind of bias and interpretation twice removed. If you really want to sort of authoritatively talk about a study, you really need to read it and, you know, sort of comb through it. And it's hard work. Studies are not easy to read. But one study that comes up with some perhaps striking results is one study. And we know that you can already find, in most cases, you know, we talk about the study that shows that using positive punishment it creates all kinds of side effects and dogs learn better through positive reinforcement. We all jump on that study because it supports our own bias.
Correct.
And you can also find studies out there that may tell you the exact opposite. So until you review the whole body of work, you'll really just sort of supporting your own bias when you grab the study that you read and you go, yep, I like that one. I'm going to talk about that one. But I thought it was interesting about the stripes and checks and all in terms of assessments for shelter dogs. But also, you know, for we as training professionals to think about what am I wearing when I'm meeting a client and their dog.
Just going back to that study question, because what makes me chuckle a little bit about studies is, when, first of all, people do exactly what you say, but to take that just one step further is, when somebody wants to defer to an expert and they want to cite something to give their own words more punch, and they'll go to Google Scholar and they'll find a study, and it costs money to purchase it, because many of the best ones do, unless you're lucky enough to have access. One of the things I regret about not being in a university course is that you don't get access to the library. And they'll literally take the summary, because that's the only thing that the public gets to see, and they'll quote the summary.
Right, the abstract.
The abstract. My goodness. I mean,
there is a lovely site called, you're probably familiar with, Plos One. It's spelled P-L-O-S, new word, O-N-E, and that's free access studies. Now, it's not every study out there, but there are lots of good studies on that site.
Right.
So it's open access. Yeah. Even if you're not at a university, so that's quite helpful.
Excellent. Interesting.
Did you say that was plus with an O?
P L O S O N E, two words.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah, and on that same topic, actually, if you take it back right to the beginning step as well, you've got to say that whoever's doing the study is already biased, aren't they? Or else they
right.
wouldn't be
and
doing
and then you
that
look at who's
study.
Funding the study. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I do want to say another another great resource for studies is, what's the name of the publication? We have a partnership with PPG. It's the Journal of Veterinary Behavior, Clinical Applications and Research.
Yeah.
PPG has a partnership with them, which that partnership alone is worth the price of PPG membership, because I was subscribing to this prior to the PPG partnership, and the annual subscription fee is now over $200. And as a PPG member, it's $45.
Yeah, it's a great benefit. It really is.
A fantastic benefit. I encourage my students to join PPG anyway, but I tell them, look, just for the cost of the subscription to this magazine, it's worth joining PPG.
That's the one. Dr. Karen Overall is the managing editor, isn't she?
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you know it's got to be good.
Yeah. Excellent. Yeah, thank you for plugging that membership benefit
part. there are lots of great benefits, but that is definitely, wow, that's a substantial reduction, isn't it, in the cost?
That's huge, absolutely, yeah.
Absolutely. Okay, Pat, well, I'd like to continue and actually chat to you about your three upcoming presentations at the PPG Summit in November.
Okay.
And the first presentation is called Shape Up. Can you tell us a little bit about the learning objectives of the presentation and actually what attendees can expect?
Certainly, the learning objective is, you know, primarily to learn more about, understand shaping, and for those, it's a lab, so for those who are attending with dogs, to practice, improve their own shaping skills and their own dog's understanding of shaping. Shaping is such a cool training technique, and again, old-fashioned training. Who would have thought that we would at some point in our lives appreciate the value of having a dog offer behaviors rather than waiting to be told what to do? So shaping, and I'm not a pure shaper. I do plenty of luring with my own dogs, and we certainly do luring in our own classes, but I really love shaping. And some of the things we do is we start with what I call a body parts exercise, where you are shaping some piece of your dog to do some behavior. So you have your dog sitting in front of you, and perhaps you're shaping him to blink. Perhaps you're shaping him to move one ear. Perhaps you're shaping him to turn his head one direction or the other, or lower his head, or lift a paw, front paw, hind paw. The value of that is that it really opens our eyes to how much we can, and control is not the right word, influence even very subtle body movements of our dogs. That training, shaping doesn't have to be about great big behaviors. We can very quickly shape a dog to turn his head slightly to one side or to move an ear back. Just really, really subtle thing. And then, of course, we have to play the 101 things to do with a prop, which is the classic shaping game. And the value of that is, especially for dogs who haven't done shaping, is that it really builds a repertoire of behaviors that they will start offering when you want to teach them something new. So, for example, Josie, the little dog that I'm holding in, little dog, she's not that little, 35 pounds, that I'm holding in the picture on the screen, I had done a lot of shaping with her, and I got this basket at a yard sale. Yard sales, by the way, are one of the greatest resources or sources of training equipment, non-traditional training equipment. So I got this wicker basket at a yard sale that looks like, I call it a Wizard of Oz basket because it looks like the basket that kind of that Toto jumped out of on the bicycle. And I thought, well, wouldn't it be fun to shape her to open that basket with her nose? Thinking that, well, that's a relatively complicated behavior. It's going to take me some time. She got it in no time because she had such a good reinforcement, past reinforcement history of being rewarded for offering different behaviors. I didn't have to wait long for her to offer a nose behavior, and then we just took it from there. So there are behaviors I watch dogs do, and I go, there's no way you could have ever taught that dog to do that using coercion or force. That the value of shaping is that we can get all kinds of complex behaviors with our dogs being willing partners, and it's a game. It's a fun game. So we do that. We also ask participants in the workshop to offer their own behavior that they would like to shape. And we sort of select, help them select behaviors that are manageable in the limited time that we have in the workshop. So we do a variety of different things, and it's a ton of fun.
Awesome. And I so wish that I could attend with a dog, but unfortunately.
You're a little far, right?
I live too far away to bring my dog with me. I'll be attending, but without the dog.
Okay.
Yeah, no, I love shaping as well. To be honest, I love luring, I love shaping, love capturing behaviors. Mm-hmm. I think shaping is so useful for, like you said, those behaviors that you honestly couldn't get them in another way. You know, there's no other way really of getting these behaviors. And yeah, it's amazing. I shaped my little stuffed Chibble Terrier to get my washing out of the washing machine. So he has to open, first of all, the cupboard door and then the washing machine door. Get the laundry out, put it in the basket, close the doors, and just by breaking the behavior down and shaping sort of really carefully, and it's just brilliant. You know, it's great fun, and I think it's good that they gain such confidence as well, don't they, from the shaping?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I do think it's a brilliant confidence boost to them, and as you said, it builds the repertoire of behaviors, and Okay, cool. And your next presentation is called Copy That. And we sort of touched on this before, but it's training dogs with imitation.
Right. And it's
how effective do you think this is?
Well, it's an interesting question. This workshop will be similar to the one that I did last year at the summit. And it's such a new approach to training. I have a couple of students who really have stuck with it and continue to work with it. And I certainly don't have anybody that's like showing an obedience competition having done all their training through imitation, and I don't think that's the goal. But for one thing, it's really amazing to watch when you see dogs who start to understand an entirely new cognitive concept, the idea that they can grasp that a cue doesn't mean a specific behavior in this case, that the cue means do whatever I just did. That's so foreign to us in training our dogs and to our dogs in learning from us that there's a fairly steep learning curve in the beginning. So I do have a couple of students who can fairly easily now demonstrate a new behavior to their dogs and have their dogs figure it out fairly quickly. So that's really exciting to see. And every time I do one of these workshops, we sit around and talk at the end, and we keep saying, what we need is somebody to try this with a puppy. Because we're all doing it with dogs that have a long history of learning the way we've always taught, which is this cue means this behavior. And it would be very interesting to see if a puppy could catch on more quickly than our adult dogs do in doing these things. So one of the things we found, and Claudia Fugazza, the creator of this whole do-as-I-do process, is that new behaviors that involve props are easier for the dogs than new behaviors that just involve a body movement that you do. And it makes sense, because at least the dog gets really quickly, it's about that thing. I'm supposed to do something with that thing, as opposed to, well, how did she move her hand, and what do I do that imitates moving her hand? So there are some challenges with it, but it's intriguing, it's really interesting, and again, it's a ton of fun.
Yeah, I've used this protocol, and I've got to admit that when I first started using it, it took quite a while for my dog to actually understand the protocol. So and it did. I was surprised it did take, you know, I'm not going to say even a couple of sessions. It was a lot of sessions over a long period of time before he caught on. And but I've managed to do some really interesting things with it. Even, you know, like you say, with props, I think it's easier, because if I'm interacting with an object, like you said, there's that visual cue already. It's to do with.
Yeah, but it does take a lot of upfront loading. Yeah. So I think It's going to be a while before it becomes a mainstream training technique. Certainly not something I'm going to introduce in my basic good manners classes and expect owners to even come close to, other than sort of the occasional, every once in a while we get somebody who's really a behavior geek in our basic training classes, and then we grab them and hold them close for forever. But but because it's more complicated, because there's a lot of upfront loading for to get the dog to understand the concept, I think we're a ways from it becoming mainstream.
Is it a difficult topic to do at a convention or a summit, because in terms of having people actually be able to get results from it in the workshop?
I was actually surprised by how well some of the dogs did in this last summit. That in the space of, I think we had a couple of hours, we had dogs who seemed to be understanding the concept. So partly, I find, we talk about for phase one, we need three behaviors that are already solidly on verbal cue so that we can get them to understand that we're not asking for a specific behavior with the cue. We practice with those three behaviors. And the more solidly the dog has those three behaviors on verbal cue, it seems to be the easier they, and more quickly they grasp the concepts.
Right.
So, yeah, I was a little skeptical about doing a two-hour workshop at Summit, but it went far better than I had anticipated.
I can't believe you just used that word, because that was the word that was about to come out of my mouth. I was going to ask you if, I mean, I have the DVD. I buy every DVD and every book. It doesn't mean I watch or read them. I seem to like collecting things. But I have the DVD on this, and I have to confess, I've never watched it. And I was a bit of a skeptic. Were you a bit of a skeptic when it first came out? Did it actually take some digging and some research to think, yeah, there's something in this?
I've bought Claudia Fugaz's 8-hour DVD set and watched it from beginning to end and was captivated. So and then I tried it with my dog, Bonnie, for a whole dog journal article. And she got it reasonably quickly. So I wasn't super skeptical from the beginning about the possibility of it. I was captivated.
Right. Did you do what a lot of people did, and that sort of look at the DVD and sort of look for subtle cues? Were you looking initially for subtle cues for the behaviors? Because I know a couple of people have actually spent a considerable amount of time going through it, and they don't believe they buy into it even now. I think they are absolutely dead certain that there is a three-term contingency going on, and there's definitely a cue system at hand.
Oh, yeah, no, I don't think so. In Claudia's first DVD set, the 8-hour one, she's pointing out when people are like, and usually the subtle cues aren't intentional.
Right.
They're the inadvertent body language things we don't even realize that we do. But Claudia's really good about, on her DVD, about pointing those out and helping people eliminate those cues. So, no, I don't think it's a clever Hans thing. I think that dogs truly can get it.
Right. Well, I mean, we see it socially, don't we? We see dogs imitating other dogs socially. I mean, watching them do behaviors and then copying them, like, you know, escaping through fences and other stuff. So I definitely think there's something in it. But you've actually motivated me now to take the cellophane off my DVD pack and watch it.
Well, good.
Thanks.
You should do, Niki. It's actually good fun. I did the same. I got the whole 8 hours, and I watched it through, and then I actually watched it through again in short sections, and that's uh-huh. how I then sort of went through the protocol with my dog, sort of teaching mm-hmm. it, okay, well, this is the first step, this is the second step. And I was very much aware of what you just talked about, making sure that I didn't cue in any other way, either by looking in a certain direction at an object yep. or, you know, and once he'd understood the protocol, I have to say that I, for one, am convinced that he's not responding to any other cue that I'm giving. Mm-hmm. He is copying what I do. Now, what yes. I will say is that I don't think it's probably as precise as, for example, if I shaped a behavior. He copies it mm-hmm. and he'll do the behavior. But it's just that precision that, you know, when you microslice behavior down and you build it up with shaping, you can get a very, very precise behavior. And I think some of the things that I've done with the imitation are perhaps a little bit I'm going to say sloppier, if that makes sense.
I don't know whether you And I think that. I think you can probably combine them. I think you can probably initiate a behavior through imitation so that you get the general idea, and then you could shape the precision.
Okay, so that might actually be one of the benefits of using it then, that you introduce the behavior in this way, and then you basically clean it up a little bit.
You can like skip the first 20 steps of your shaping plan and go right to step 21.
Yeah. And the other thing is, of course, it does look so impressive as well. You do this, and somebody's watching you, and you just say, okay, do this. Yep. And it does. It's a good crowd pleaser.
Do you think it's a concept that trainers can run curriculums in their own businesses as pet owners, or do you think that it's probably a little bit too far removed from that because of the complexity?
I think it depends on their market. If they have a large enough market, then they probably could get the number of people they need to be able to offer it as a service. I'm sort of out in the middle of nowhere here in Fairplay, and I don't know that my close market is immediate enough for that. When I offer workshops, it's pretty generally other trainers or really serious dog hobbyists who come to the workshop here.
Right. So maybe that's why it's been a bit slower. Maybe that's why it's being adopted a little bit more slowly, because maybe a lot of professional trainers are not seeing the commercial value of it.
I think as well that a lot of professional trainers, Niki, don't actually understand what it is, because I've seen some trainers saying that they're using this protocol and actually they're not really using it at all, you know. They think they're doing it, but they're not.
You could probably say that about a lot of things in dog training.
A lot of things in dog training.
I've seen people that... I think that they've taught the copy that cue is basically is another cue for a specific behavior, and that the dog's doing, do you understand what I'm saying? That the dog's doing, he's got a repertoire of maybe four or five things, and he's recognized the do it, for example, cue as a cue. Okay, we're in this situation, so it means this. So the environment is given another cue.
Particularly if it involves a prop, because that's kind of the dead giveaway about what you're asking the dog to do. But yeah, I don't know. Yeah. I haven't seen, other than my own workshops, and I have done a couple of 6-week classes with the handful of my clients that are really, really dedicated trainers. So I haven't watched a lot of other trainers try to apply it. So you may well be right.
Yeah, obviously, like I've seen an awful lot of good examples of it, especially on Claudia's CD, some really good examples. But I've also, because I'm quite interested in tricks, I've seen a lot of trick trainers have actually sort of caught on to this. But when I watch closely, I think, the dog's not got it. And I think maybe that's what makes other people skeptical about the process. Because
they're seeing some faulty applications.
Exactly, yeah. And there's quite a lot of it out there, you know, if you look on YouTube and you think, no, that's not it. But that doesn't mean to say that I don't think it works, because I do. I think Nikki's question about whether it could be used in a curriculum is an interesting one. And I think, Niki, from my experience, I think it'd be very, Pat's just said the opposite, actually, that some caught on really quickly. But from my experience, just with my own dog, it took him a long time to...
And that's certainly more my experience. The ones that caught on quickly were dogs at the summit belonging to skilled trainers, and I think that the behaviors they chose were behaviors that the dogs favored anyway.
Wasn't there one dog that did that jump?
That leap up in the air, yeah. So I think they were behaviors that were easily elicited because the dogs were eager to do them anyway.
Right.
Yeah, that
makes
sense.
Yeah, I do a lot of business consulting with small businesses, and you know, a lot of people they're always looking to increase the revenue that is coming into the business. Uh-huh. So you know, I think it's one of the reasons why people jump on all these sort of acronyms and all these new programs so quickly, because it's yet another spoke on the wheel. And I look at this and think, you know, and I do believe, I absolutely think it's got validity. I will take the time to learn it. Maybe when you're here next week, Louise, we can have a go at it. But I struggle with how easily you could implement that into a business because you mm-hmm. have to have these three behaviors that are front loaded, blah, 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 blah.
Right.
Yeah. So it's interesting stuff.
Right. Although I do understand both from people who have watched and some of the more recent Claudia videos that I've watched that some of the things she was very fixed about in that first 8-hour DVD have softened a little. So, for example, in that DVD, you were 6 to 8 feet away from your dog when you did the demonstration. Now, apparently, you can be much closer, which makes it easy for some dogs who are a little confused when you ask them to do behavior 8 feet away because that's not usually what you do.
Right.
Yeah, that's right. It was very specific, wasn't it, that you've got to yes. always be facing the same way, same distance. Yes.
And I still think some of that is true. You don't want your position to be part of the cue because then you are cueing. So you do still want to be, you know, start each behavior in the same position in the same place, but you don't have to be 8 feet away.
Right, yeah. Okay, so obviously I need to watch some of her newer stuff as well then to find out exactly what has changed.
Yeah.
And then teach it with my second dog and see if I can teach it more quickly. Yeah, that would be interesting. Okay, let's go on to your next presentation at the summit, actually, Reactive Rovers, which obviously Nikki's already mentioned, and this is working mm-hmm. with dog reactive dogs rather
and
than people
this,
reactive dogs.
Yeah, this one is lecture only because I certainly don't want to be asking people to bring their dog reactive dogs to the summit. So it's a discussion of the, you know, what is dog reactive behavior and what are the various ways we can work with it, and what do I find most effective? We do 3-day Reactive Rover workshops here. We only accept 6 dogs, and the entire workshop is completely choreographed, so you never come around a corner and bump into another dog. So everybody gets the chance to relax with their dogs and do 3 days of solid counter conditioning. So they can make a lot of progress in 3 days. But this session is a lecture session. There'll be video of different techniques, and we'll talk about different approaches, as well as some of the management tools that and operant stuff we can do for reactivity.
Awesome. And do you think, I know you sort of touched on this a little bit, but do you think that we are actually seeing more reactive dogs now than in the past, or do you think it's just that people are labeling the dogs perhaps in the same way as they're labeling?
I think it's both. I mean, I have clients who have told me their dogs are reactive because they bark when somebody rings the doorbell. Well, a lot of dogs do that, and that's not what I would call reactivity. So we talk about, I like to use Karen Overall's definition of reactivity, which is an over-aroused, abnormal response to a normal stimulus. And it's sometimes based in aggression, and sometimes it's not. So we talk a lot about what reactivity is. And do I think we're seeing more of it? I think I've talked with other trainers about this a lot. Are we seeing more aggression? Are we seeing reactivity? And I think the answer is yes, and I think there are a lot of reasons why, and that's one of the things we talk about in the workshop. But certainly I think one reason is that people are more responsible now. So dogs are kept safely at home, maybe in the backyard, maybe in the house. But when I was a kid, dogs ran loose all the time. So they were very well socialized. They also got hit by cars and poisoned and, you know, kidnapped and everything else, but by keeping them safely at home now, which has become more of a cultural norm in many communities, dogs have less opportunity to become well socialized with other dogs and other stimuli that are now causing reactive behavior. So that's one reason, but I'm not going to tell you the rest. Yeah. You have to come see me.
I was going to say, do you think laws as well, for example, leash laws, may have something to do with this?
I think that goes along with, yes, they're not running at large anymore. So, yes, whereas maybe you took your dog for a walk around the block off leash before, and again, he got the opportunity to run up and meet other dogs and other people, now you're taking him for walks around the block on leash. And my rule here is we don't allow dogs to greet nose-to-nose on leash because that can create all kinds of issues, including reactivity. So yeah, I would say that plays into it.
Yeah, and do you think dog reactive behavior is actually preventable then?
I would say for the most part, you can have a very well socialized dog who gets jumped on by another dog and ends up being reactive as a result, and that one might not be preventable, but I think a lot of reactivity is preventable.
Awesome. Well, I'm really looking forward to all of your presentations. I can't wait.
Thank you.
We've had a few more questions in.
Okay.
One of them actually, maybe Niki can answer this. It was how to access the discount for the Journal of Veterinary Behavior, Niki.
I answered that, but if you're
you did.
I actually answered and deleted some of the ones that have been answered. I think there's a couple up there that you can probably ask, Pat. But in answer to the veterinary behavior, if you're a Pet Professional Guild member and you log into the member area of the website, there is a page there that has all the vendor discounts on and all the information that you need in terms of the code and who to contact and how to. The information's there for ordering it.
Thanks, Niki. Well, if you want to go through the other questions, as you know what you've asked and what you haven't asked.
Okay, well,
any in particular?
There is one question that came in from John Robertson. I'll get to that in just a moment. And there's a couple of other more comments than Billy No Mate, Kelly Fahey, who's one of our PPG steering committee members, says Pat's reactive rover workshops are so well thought out and choreographed. I didn't know what to expect, but I wasn't expecting the setup that she has. I'm very impressive. So
thanks, Kelly.
There you go, from one of your adamant big supporters. And then Susan Zarbin, who says, love you, Pat, but I've earned your highest certification today. At what point do I actually become Pat Miller?
Cute, Susan.
I think probably what you need to do, Pat, is have a level 4 certification so that Susan can jump onto that one. Okay. And then we do have a question that came in from John Robertson, and it says about the aggression issue. Do the trainers hosting this session believe that BAT is an appropriate form of training to reduce aggression? So, there's a question. So I don't know if anybody wants to answer that.
Okay, I can answer that. I will have to admit, first of all, that I have not fully familiarized myself with BAT 2.0, which is Grisha's current version of BAT. When BAT was first released, I found it confusing. I read her book and tried to work with a guinea pig client, and I was confused. And if I'm confused, I know my client's going to be confused. And then I had a trainer show me kind of a simplified version of the first level of BAT, and I was able to use and apply that and yes, found it useful. The simplified version involves more simply, rather than looking for the cutoff signals that Grisha talks about, you install a signal, and generally it's a conditioned emotional response. You do some counter conditioning. So when your dog, for example, if you're talking about other dogs, you do some counter conditioning, so when your dog sees another dog, they have an automatic kind of look at you because they're anticipating the chicken that you're going to feed them as you're doing counter conditioning. And once you get that, then you set up markers at specific distances, so you're not just watching for a cutoff signal. You walk to the first marker and you wait for that conditioned emotional response, look back, and then you run away. So with that simplified version, I have used that and yes, found it useful. I don't know about 2.0 because I don't know enough about it yet.
Okay, excellent. And Grisha is a huge proponent of empowerment training and, you know, making sure that animals feel comfortable. So and she also researches everything particularly well. So I don't do very much work with dogs anymore. I don't do any work with aggression dogs. So I cannot in any way comment because I'm not familiar with the program, so
I will say that counter conditioning is my first choice because I've had tons of success with it and because I find that it's really easy in my initial 2-hour consult with a client to demonstrate and practice and have them go away on their own and be able to be successful with applying it. Whereas both with BAT and CAT, the constructional aggression treatment, it takes a lot more hand-holding from me for my clients to be able to succeed.
Right. What I have seen is that I do like, and again, I'm not in any way an expert, so anyone making a decision will have to do some research. I love the fact that there's a lot of concentration put onto leash skills, because I think that's one of the areas where pet owners tend to go wrong. And we end up with reactive dogs because of the way that we are, you know, leash walking them. So I think that's absolutely fabulous. And I think as well, there's a lot of focus on using functional rewards, rewards within the environment rather than using food, I believe. But again, I haven't read the BAT 2.0, so I'm not sure. You're probably a better authority than I am to speak to that.
Okay, well, I don't think there are actually any more questions, are there, Niki?
I don't think so, no. Yeah, all the questions are done.
I think we've gone through them all.
And, if you don't mind, Louise, you brought up
too much time.
Louise, if you don't mind, you brought up one. When we first started talking before we were on air, you brought up one someone had asked about.
Yeah, I did. You're right.
My animal control experience, the one that went back there.
We actually had a couple of questions in, yes, that were sent in beforehand. One was from Kelly Fahey, actually, who has left a comment on here as well. And she said, you've done so much work in your career working as an animal control officer, educating people through your books and articles for the Whole Dog Journal and helping to produce educational force-free trainers. Do you have any other goals that you would like to achieve or projects that you would like to do?
Okay. I prompted you to ask that question because I wanted the opportunity to talk about this experience that I had. When I was at the Marine Humane Society for 20 years, and I loved it. It was a dream career for me. And I left there because my husband was director of operations at the Monterey SPCA, which is a couple hours south of San Francisco, and Marin is a half hour north of San Francisco. So we were only seeing each other on weekends, and it just felt like time to move on. And one of the things I loved about the Marin Humane Society was we didn't just stay in Marin County. We got to speak at conferences around the country. If there was a fire up in Yolo County, we got sent up there to help. If there was an earthquake in Santa Cruz, we got sent down there to help. So I felt like our reach was beyond our own county, that we were really making a difference to animals all over. And ironically, I told my husband when I left there and went to Monterey, Santa Cruz to start a little dog training business that my biggest concern was that I was going to not have as much of a reach, or I wasn't going to have as much of an effect on a larger population than just the local dogs. So that was a little ironic. But anyway, in terms of future, I'm open. I'm delighted to be going to speak at the New Zealand APDT conference at the end of May. So that's a very cool thing for me. And then, boy, just to keep on keeping on, keep on working with people, working with trainers so that my reach does go beyond, you know, my own training center walls. And I know that the Cognition Academy, I believe, was a suggestion of one of my past students. So I'm always looking for ideas from others as far as new articles to write or new topics to write on for articles and new ideas for new academies. So I would say that the primary goal is just to keep on keeping on.
Keep on keeping on.
Awesome. And I can definitely say that your reach has gone much further than local dogs.
Yeah, I realize that.
And so when can we expect to see you in Europe?
In Europe? Well, somebody has to invite you. Hint, hint.
Okay. I know. Why don't we invite Pat? Because we're doing a mini summit in England in September. There's just four of us going over there to meet and
greet. She's invited, quick. Come on, Niki, get this invite out.
No, I'm just wondering. So we're hoping that next year, in 2017, it will be slightly bigger. So we'll have to invite Pat to come out to do that.
Keep me in mind, absolutely.
There you go. Okay.
Excellent. That's I'm making a note of that already in my diary. That would be fantastic. We actually had another question come through before the show as well, and it was, do you recommend OTC calming support products to many of your clients with reactive dogs?
Okay, so over-the-counter calming products, I talk about them. And so my favorite of the month is L-theanine. which is available as Angsitane, specifically made for dogs at about 4 times the cost of the over-the-counter Alfanine that's made for humans. And with the caveat that the chewable variety made for humans has xylitol in it, which is deadly toxic for dogs, so you don't want the chewable variety. I talk about it with clients, and I always say, check with your veterinarian to make sure they're okay with you using this because they know your dog's health status, and I don't. So I don't say, go get L-theanine. I don't say, go get Composure, which is a blend of a number of different things and includes a subclinical level of L-theanine, I believe, or Calm Ease, some of those. I will mention that those are options, and I always pair that with check with your veterinarian and make sure there's nothing that your dog is already on or doing that would make that a contraindicated, you know, that would be a problem of some kind. Because even though they're over the counter, we walk a little bit of a fine line if we start recommending those things. You know, we're all very conscious of not overstepping our bounds and, you know, practicing veterinary medicine without a license. So I'll include information. Same thing if they ask me what to feed their dogs. I don't recommend a diet. I will give them a handout that says, here's how to look for a good quality food, but I don't want to tell them a specific food that I think they should be feeding their dogs. So it's the same thing with those over-the-counter calming products.
Yeah, we have to be really careful. Yeah,
so the basic advice is, well, here's some information, but you really need to speak to your veterinary professional. Yeah,
and that might be a little bit being overcautious because they are over-the-counter things, but I want to stay on good terms with the veterinarians whose clients I'm working with, and I think it never hurts to say, just check in with your vet and make sure they're okay. I don't think it means you need to take your dog in for a full checkup. Just give your vet a quick phone call and ask them if they're comfortable with you doing something like this.
Perfect. And another question that we had in was whether you had any suggestions or strategies for professionals discussing the topic of reactivity with clients.
discussing the topic of reactivity with clients. That's a huge question, and I'm not sure how to answer it in this format. I certainly have some articles available that have information on working with reactive dogs, and if whoever asked that question wanted to contact me, I can send a couple of those articles to him or her, or they could come see my presentation at the PPG Summit.
Awesome, and hopefully they'll actually be doing that. How can people sign up for the summit, Niki?
If you go to forcefreesummit.com or petprofessionalguild.com and then click on the 2016 summit.
Thank you very much,
Niki. And they can make payments.
Yes, you can make payments. Interest-free monthly payments. So we don't make money off people by charging interest. We want to make it more affordable for people. We want to make it easier for people to sign up.
Yep, so, and I said this at last year's PPG Summit, and I want to say it again, the best dog trainer conference I've attended. So if you're on the fence, let me push you off to the right side of the fence. Come in November.
Excellent. Pat, can you, obviously we appreciate that testimonial because it's huge, but what in particular did you enjoy as a presenter? What was it that sort of pushed you off the fence and made you feel comfortable making that statement?
I think two things. One, it was the ambiance was so inviting that it's probably the only dog trainer conference I've been to where there wasn't like backbiting and snarking, and it just everybody seemed to be having such a good time and so positive about everything. I mean, it was your first time and there were some glitches and nobody was, you know, whining or bitching about the glitches. We would bring things to somebody's attention and they were clearly listening and, you know, then we would move on. Yeah. The other thing is that it feels like it was us. I mean, I've been to Clicker Expo and Clicker Expo's terrific, wonderful information, and it's Karen Pryor and her people putting it on. And PPG Summit felt like it was us. So there was really an ownership piece to it that felt really nice.
Well, and I'm really glad to hear you say that, because I think our goal with PPG has always been about the members helping other members. I mean, we're a member organization, so we never sort of wanted a corporate structure where people felt it was sort of a corporate environment and then the members. We always wanted it to be a very member-centric, member-driven organization. Mm-hmm.
So, mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think that came through clearly at the summit.
Yeah, I'm really excited about this year, because I think we learned a lot from last year. We made some mistakes, and we got a lot of really good feedback from people. We asked the question, what did you like, what did you not like, and we got some great feedback. And I think this year the hotel is far better. Everything's under one roof. I'm actually really excited about the evening activities this year. And last year we had a hoot with the treasure hunt, but I think this year it's going to be a hoot with the quiz night. It's going to be fun. I'm really excited. I think this year is going to be a great year, because we're going to England to do the mini summit in September, then we come back, and then we've got the November summit. So it's just really, really exciting. And it's nice to just be around people that you can learn from, that you feel comfortable asking questions of. You're not being judged by anybody. It was just a really nice atmosphere.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's fabulous. Thank you for that.
Mm-hmm. I've got to admit, I'm really excited about it, and I'm actually pretty pleased that you mentioned the treasure hunt, Niki, because Susan and I had great fun with the treasure hunt last year, didn't we?
Yeah, that's because there was only two of you, because nobody else wanted to be on your team.
There were just two of us, Pat. That's why we got the hashtag, the Billy No Mates hashtag, because there were just Susan and myself on a team by ourselves. And unfortunately, we managed to come in last.
I was going to say, the only thing that I was disappointed about the treasure hunt was that my team didn't win. We tried really hard.
Don't worry, because Susan and I were behind you. So.
Well, when I got to the
we
final,
joined your team.
when I got to the final location and saw the two of them sitting there, I thought, oh my God, they must have answered all the questions correctly. They've got here in record-breaking speed. And then I was laughing as we marked. Becca was marking all the answer sheets, and we were chuckling. Still, Susan's actually on this. Yeah, I think Susan's listening, so there you go, Susan. Anyway, all right, well, that's all from me. I mean, anything else from you, Louise?
No, that's all from me, except a massive, massive thank you to Pat for coming on the show. That's
oh, most welcome. Very
amazing.
Enjoyable. Love talking to you guys.
Yeah, thanks, Pat. We always love to catch up with you and find out what you're doing, so we really appreciate you taking time out of your Sunday. So, without any further ado, thank you everybody for joining us. This is being recorded, so you can catch it later. And just to recap very quickly, Louise, our next show is on what day?
Our next show is actually on April the 20th, and it's another special edition, and we'll be speaking to Victoria Stillwell.
Wonderful. Excellent. Okay, so hopefully we'll see you all there.
And if not there, in November.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. So if we don't see you in our next show, we'll see you at the summit in November.
There you go.
Have fun, everybody.
All right, bye.
Bye.
Bye.